Fellow members, good afternoon. We formed a quorum. It's the appointed time. This is the Bills Committee on Inland Revenue Amendment No. 6 Bill 2017. This is its seventh meeting. Well, we've held many meetings. Well, thank you for working so hard. First, the Secretariat has issued a paper, CB bracket 1. 899/1718, and that is the minutes of the meeting held on the 21st of March 2018. As of now, the Secretariat has not received any proposed amendments, so let's confirm the minutes. No question? Minutes confirmed. Mr. Wong Ting Kwong, confirm. Yes, okay. Next, there is another paper. It's CB bracket 1, 941/17-18, bracket 01. This is submitted by the administration, and that is the draft amendments proposed by the administration. This is a consolidated version, including both batches 1 and batch 2 amendments. We have started clause-by-clause scrutiny last time, and like what we did last time, when we come to the relevant sections, so we'll discuss the relevant proposed amendments. Now, in the last meeting, we were up to clause 9. For the blue bill, this is page C2766 in the English version. And if we look at the marked copy, it's page 0027 in the Chinese version. If it is in the English version, it's again 0027. Okay, once again, we are on Division 2, and the heading is Division 2, Computation of Income or Loss. Subdivision 1, Provision Between Associated Persons. So we'll start from here. Okay, are you with me, members? Okay, so can we now, Mr. Ronick Chan? I thought you were raising your hand to raise a question. Well, you're just waving your hand to say that you're here, huh? Chairman, the administration has given us CB bracket 1941/17-18 bracket 01. I wonder whether an updated paper would be presented to us next time. Can you not give us the paper earlier? It was given to us only in the evening on Friday, and then we didn't. My colleagues haven't worked over the weekend, so I just got a chance to read it just now. So can the Diaz tell us exactly what is in this updated paper? So, Deputy Secretary, please briefly mention or take us through this, because when we come to this clause-by-clause scrutiny, we will go to the relevant sections. So, Diaz, can you briefly talk about this in 5 to 10 minutes? Mr. Lai, can you do that? Take us through this consolidated version of the paper. So, I must apologize to the members first. Now, this is a consolidated version of the draft CSAs that was presented to you only towards the end of last week. But please appreciate that there are altogether 56 CSAs, and among them, 45 were submitted when we had the meeting last time. It's now that for the remaining 11 that were also presented. So we save you the trouble of having to look at two documents. The remaining 11 CSAs were included in this paper. It's marked in blue. So the parts marked in black were the CSAs presented last time. And for the 11 CSAs marked in blue, what are they about? There are three. They are in three main areas. First, in response to members' earlier views expressed for associated companies and their relevant transactions, if there is no tax interest involved, can we exempt them from the advance transfer pricing mechanism? And for the relevant instruments, we have moved the CSAs to try to put that into the law. Secondly, for the transfer for pricing instruments, in relation to the master copy and the local copy of the report, in terms of the assets and the total revenue, as agreed by all of us, it will be the $400 million as the total income, and then the asset is going to be is $300 million. So these are the two figures to be put in. Now, thirdly, in 26AB, in response to the latest proposed amendments from the OECD, we are just making some changes to the drafting. So these are the three areas whereby the latest CSAs will fall into. So later on, when we go to the relevant clauses, we will talk about these CSAs so that you can compare them with the original drafting. So any further questions in general? If not, then I suggest that we will continue with our clause-by-clause scrutiny, starting from 50 AAF. I'm looking at the English version myself. I think your members are free to read through the English or Chinese version. Mr. Chu, are you going to use the English version? Yes, I will be using the English version. But when you explain orally, try to talk about it in Chinese. All right, page 0027, 50 AAF, Rule 1, that is, in brief, that is about the arm's length principle for provision between associated persons. Now, what do we mean by that? Say, if there is an actual provision which has been made between two persons, and that's under A, and then under B, the participation condition is met. And then C, the actual provision differs from the provision that would have been made between independent persons. And as a result, there is a potential advantage resulted in relation to Hong Kong tax. Then the IRD can, in accordance with the arm's length provision, made the relevant adjustment to the tax charged. Well, let me repeat. There is an actual provision between two persons made, and then the participation condition is met, and then the actual provision is not made in accordance with the arm's length principle, and then there is a potential advantage in relation to Hong Kong tax results. So when we calculate the tax, we should do it based on the arm's length principle. This phrase was drafted based on the English laws, which is again based on the OECD's principles. All right, let me continue. How do we determine whether the actual provision differs from the provision that would have been made at the arm's length principle? Now, under the arm's length provision, then these will not be the provisions made between the two persons. That's subparagraph 2. Then 3, an SM may give a notice to the advantaged person requiring the person to prove that the amount of the person's income or loss as stated in the person's tax return is the arm's length amount. Paragraph 4.
可以发出
In bracket 4, a notice may be given under subsection 3 whether or not any assessment has already been made or any computation of loss has already been issued. Subclause 5, subsection 5 says that if the advantaged person fails to prove to the assessor's satisfaction that the amount of the person's income or loss as stated in the person's tax return is the arm's length amount, the assessor must estimate an amount as the arm's length. I need to pause here to explain because the IR ordinance allows the assessor discretion to assess the taxable amount. And the current ordinance requires the assessor to objectively run a procedure and issue an opportunity for the person being assessed to explain, and if they cannot explain, then an assessment can be made. So this discretion is more careful. So no matter what, when the assessor assesses the tax, the person or the company, they have an appeal right that will not change, and the taxpayer's rights have not been diminished. Mr. Zhong, I understand the current operation, but we come across cases where the tax assessors, they assess the tax, and the amount they assess is groundless. To put it bluntly, they just blindly guess, and the company needs to explain to the assessor that they were wrong. Well, I think there's a problem here. So, could the director explain a bit? On what grounds will an assessor come up with a taxable amount? Okay. Now, Mr. Chong's question is an important question. The IRD will deal with that very seriously, even though the ordinance allows the assessor the authority to make an assessment. I need to point out that there have been some court rulings in the past that tax assessors need to be based on fact. In other words, the taxpayers can rest assured the tax assessor cannot come up with an assessment without proof or evidence. They need to have a factual basis. They have to receive information, and after analysis, it has to be believable, or they have made some comparisons and calculations, and the motivation is to ensure the taxable income. It cannot be an assessment based on non-taxable income. I've seen some cases where the tax assessor has asked the enterprise. They issued a tax statement, and the enterprise says that is incorrect. And when you ask the tax assessor, on what basis does the tax assessor come up with a taxable income? But the IRD does not provide any explanation. They just say that you have to explain why you think the assessment is incorrect. Well, the enterprises don't know how the assessor came up with the amount, so how can they tell the assessor that they were wrong? So the IRD will never provide that information, and that creates, I feel, inequity. You say that I'm wrong, and I say you are wrong, and the enterprise asks for the assessor for information, the assessor doesn't provide the information. and then they make you pay the tax first. I feel that's problematic. Does the tax assessor, even though I understand, as the director said, that they have to have some basis, but what it's they it's the, only the IRD is aware of the basis. They won't explain it to the taxpayer. So so the ordinance says that you have to purchase a tax coupon and then pay it up, pay up first, and then we can negotiate. So what are the rules? Why can't they tell us? Thank you, Chairman. As I explained just now, any tax assessor, even though they have that legal right, but they need to have a factual basis. They need to have a legal motivation to do so. Now, if you're talking about individual cases, I cannot give you an explanation right now. But if we do have individual cases, I think the public, the taxpayer, can communicate with the assessor and see what the factual basis is. And even if they have to purchase a tax coupon, is it the full taxable amount or just a partial amount? Or even if they don't need to purchase the tax coupon and they can appeal the assessment. So these are the taxpayers' rights. Mr. Chung, I understand. We don't have an individual case to share with you. I'm just saying in general, the IRD practice, because I receive a lot of similar cases where they have a similar circumstances. So the impression that we have is that's how the IRD does things. Of course, I believe you say that there's a basis, there's a rationale for the taxable amount. But now the taxpayer says we don't know how you calculate that. And you ask the IRD, they will never disclose that information. And then you say that why you have to explain why the assessment is wrong. So as the CFO or the accountant, I don't understand how what the basis is. How do I prove that you're wrong? I don't. That is the RRD's practice. I'm not saying it's an independent case. And of course, the deputy commissioner, if you wish for an example, I can give you individual cases, but this is the kind of cases that I receive. I think Mr. Chung is asking if a tax assessor wishes to assess a tax amount, will they provide some facts and what assumptions have been made? They can list out these assumptions and come up with a taxable amount, the reassessed tax amount. Now, of course, as a taxpayer, if we see that the tax assessor comes up with a new amount, if we can examine the assumptions and provide a defense, that would be better than having just an amount without any background information. The taxpayer has to prove that the reassessed amount is wrong. That would be very difficult. I just want to understand how would things actually occur in practice. Well, let me try to convince Mr. Chung in the internal meetings of the IRD. I will raise Mr. Chung's opinion that I will require our assessors to comply with my explanation. They need to have a factual basis, they have to have legal intention, and the third, they also have to explain to the taxpayer how they arrived at the assessment value based on actual fact. But I have to, some information is based on an investigation and it's sensitive information. It might involve informal information. And typically we have a responsibility to protect the informer's identity. So in these special cases, we might not be able to disclose the information to the taxpayer. But no matter what, I have to point out that we need to provide the factual basis. Well, Deputy Commissioner said that that some cases are handled by the investigation unit. So, if there is a file, that means it's being investigated. There. So it's like when we reach this scrutiny section, for example, a foreign tax jurisdiction suspects a Hong Kong enterprise, they have some tax issues, transfer pricing problems, and they require Hong Kong IRD to deal with it. So that means we have an existing case. There has to be an investigation. So I don't understand. You mean that there are some cases where the investigation unit is involved and some cases the investigation unit is not involved? So I think Mr. Chung's question is, an investigation case and a reassessed case are two different cases. Are there separate procedures? Deputy Commissioner. Well, the assessor's assessment authority is a right that each assessor has. But in IRD, we have assessment, we have profit tax, salaries tax assessment unit. And the investigation unit is a separate unit. They don't do the everyday assessment work. They only conduct investigation work. So Mr. Chung raised the question, let's say the U.S. tax authorities make a request to Hong Kong IRD. Hong Kong IRD will not conduct an investigation on the U.S. Inland Revenue behalf. According to the tax exchange arrangement, we can only provide Hong Kong information that we agreed to provide. We only provide information that we need to provide. So we don't conduct investigation on behalf of the U.S. Yes, we won't be conducting investigation on behalf of foreign tax jurisdiction. So that clarification would ease our fears. I want the Deputy Commissioner to further clarify the enterprise's rights. When they ask the tax assessor for information, it has to be factual and it has to be legal. So if they ask for that, the tax assessor has to respond, or do they just require the tax reserve certificate to be purchased? So these are the actual cases we encounter. Well, Mr. Chung's understanding is correct. The enterprise has rights, and if we do have such cases, individual cases, as pledged just now, I will reflect that to my IRD colleagues, and the commissioner will be made aware, and we will implement the legal requirements. Well, the IRD also has internal guidelines. When you issue the reassessments, do you request the assessors to conduct their work based on factual basis and the intention is to objectively assess that tax. Do you remind them of these court rulings? Did you give them guidelines? I'm sorry, Chairman, I cannot answer you immediately.
I can't say whether we do or do not have the guidelines and where they are placed, but there are definitely court rulings. And, Chairman, you know better than me, there are definitely court rulings, and they are there to uphold or safeguard tax revenue. And we will not have any political considerations whatsoever. That can't be our motive. As for the factual basis, our guidelines always require our colleagues to conduct assessment based on facts. Now, how do we do the assessment? Let me explain further. We will resort to comparability analysis. Say, given the assets, the manpower, and the overall environment, roughly what will be the income? And then the other one is the chain analysis. Say, what are your gross profits in the past? And then, based on that, we will assess your profits for this year. These are indirect assessment methods. But in any case, the assessor must make it clear what is the approach is being adopted, and the taxpayers can query the assess methodology and then propose better assessment methods. Mr. Chung, you asked whether there are internal guidelines, and the deputy commissioner said that he can't answer the question now. Maybe he can give you an answer later on. After the meeting, I will urge them to give me a written reply. So maybe after the meeting, we can provide a written reply. On this particular provision 50AA, do you have any further questions? Yes, I have a last question. In the Inland Revenue Ordinance, well, to my knowledge, the assessor may come up with an amount. The relevant company has a burden of proof to prove that it is in the right and the assessor is in the wrong. Is there a burden of proof on the part of the enterprise, Deputy Commissioner? Like I explained, if an assessor comes up with an estimate or assessment, he must do it based on facts, and he has a good motive, and the assessment methodology is appropriate. Well, these are the criteria he should meet. Now, if these criteria are met, then it will be incumbent upon the taxpayer to point out the mistake the assessor has made. And in the appeal mechanism, when the case gets to the tax appeal board, the burden of proof rests with the enterprise, and Mr. Chung's understanding is correct. At that stage, it will be for the enterprise to give the proof, because the commissioner for IR will have to make a ruling. And then the enterprise has the burden of proof to show that the assessment is wrong. Yeah, that's another of my query. The assessor now says the enterprise has not paid the relevant tax, and that the enterprise says that it has already fully paid the tax. And then the case goes to the appeal board. Then the chair of the appeal board is the commissioner for Inland Revenue, surprisingly. Well, I think you've got it wrong, Mr. Chung. Well, because Mr. Chiu mentioned about the commissioner. Well, before the appeals board, there is another procedure to go through to the commissioner for Inland Revenue. If you are not convinced by the Commissioner of IRR's decision, then you can go to the appeal board, which is made up of three independent members. Sorry, I missed this procedure. Now, the assessor has made an assessment. The enterprise, the taxpayer disagrees with the assessment. If there is a dispute, then the commissioner for IR will have to interfere directly, and then he will make a ruling. But then that's an administrative ruling still. And Mr. Chung said that this is still somebody from the IRD. Now, if the enterprise disputes the commissioner's ruling, then he can lodge an appeal against the commissioner's ruling with the appeals board, and it is independent from the government department. And then the enterprise has the burden of proof to show that the commissioner's ruling is inappropriate. That's what I meant. Yes, I got that clear. So that's how the process works. Under common law, very often, the burden of proof rests with the prosecution side or the authorities. And it should not be the enterprise which has the burden of proof. In common law, it is for the prosecution to prove that a person is guilty. So in tax laws, it seems that it runs counter to common law principles because the benefit of doubts goes to the accused. We are now discussing tax assessment. It is not a criminal offense. It's just about how much tax you pay. And it is different from, say, criminal cases like robbery, etc. In criminal cases, the prosecution has to prove beyond reasonable doubt that an offense is committed. But if we are disputing tax payment, this is altogether a different concept. So can the Deputy Commissioner explain? Thank you, Chairman. Your understanding is correct, and Mr. Chung's understanding is also correct. For criminal cases, the burden of proof rests through the prosecution, but for tax disputes, they are of a civil nature. And for the civil cases, the proof standards or criteria do not of criminal cases do not apply. It's not a criminal court, so the standards of proof of criminal cases do not apply to civil cases. I understand that in tax cases, you are an assessor. You propose a certain amount. The deputy commissioner said that it has to be reasonable, that it should be based on facts. Well, I'll not dwell on this. I don't want to waste your time. But indeed, this is a common problem faced by those in the business sector. All right. I have a quick question for the Deputy Commissioner. Subsection 4 refers to this notice. And does it mean that the revised assessment should be done within 6 years after the assessment? Well, this is not about an assessment notice. This is just a notice to ask the taxpayer to provide certain information. So there is no limitation on the time period. If the limitation period has expired, there is no point of issuing this notice. Well, understand it. So can I continue with paragraph 6 in page 28? We have a CSA for that. Can I refer the Bills Committee to page 26 of the English version? It's 50 AAF in the middle of that page, in color, you can see that paragraph 6, 7, and 8 have been revised. Are you able to read it? Consolidated version, page 26, in the middle of the page, 50 AAF, Rule 1, arm's length principle for provision between associated persons. 6, there is amended, and also there is additional 7 and 8. So, Deputy Commissioner, please. Now, for 6, submissions from deputations, we cannot just say a more reliable measure, so we add in an equally reliable measure or a more reliable measure. That was done in response to deputation's views. We have accepted it, and we've added in that phrase. And we've added in paragraph 7 and 8. That was made in response to submissions. Paragraph 7 says that if section 15BA4 or 5 applies, then 50 AAF sections 1 to C do not apply. Now, if section 50C applies, then subsections 1 to 6 do not apply. That's in paragraph 8. That the defines the relationship between 50 AAF and 15BA4 or 5 and 15C. Deputy Commissioner, can you remind me for the last sentence in paragraph 6, some deputations that should not be the arm's length amount, but rather it should be arm's length range. Can you remind me whether arm's length amount refers to an amount or a range, and where is it set out here? Now, in paragraph page 23, there is this note for part 8A. There is new paragraph of 2A. I don't recall. I have to remind myself all the time. This concept is important. Can you continue then? Now, let's move on to 0029, and that is a participation condition. We took reference from the English laws that is to implement the OECD's principles. And it means participating in the management, control, or capital of the other affected person, or the same person or persons was or were participating in the management, control, or capital of each of the affected persons. Now, 50AAH. So, Deputy Commissioner, 50AAG and 50AAH, there are interpretations set out. Are these directly related to the concept of associated persons? Hence, so much coverage is devoted into participation condition and also participation. Is it the case? Thank you, Chairman. 50AAH, definition of participation. These are the wordings used by the OECD in local laws. That's related to the associated persons concept. Your understanding is correct. Participation is similar to associated persons in local legislation, and we are just copying the relevant drafting here. So they are more or less the same. So there's nothing new here, generally speaking. But in the primary legislation, where is the participation condition used in, you said you, well, in 50AAF1B, that is the part where it appears, because for Rule 1 of transfer pricing, there are several conditions to be met. One, there is an actual provision, there are two persons, and then there is the participation condition to be met, and that is to say one controlling the other or the two persons controlling the other person. Okay, please continue. So I have the suggestion, because 50AAH is just some standard provision. If members don't have any particular questions, then I can Well, we can just look at it very briefly. 50AH. Well, paragraph 1. Participation, it means a person A is participating in the management, control, or private capital of another person. B has to be a corporation, partnership, or trustee, or a body of persons.
And that has to be controlled by person A. So it is not an individual, not a person. And subsection 2 mentions that person A has the power to secure the that the affairs of person B are conducted in accordance with the wishes of person A. In Roman numeral 1, it says person A has more than half of the direct or indirect beneficial interests. And it also related to the associate definition. And person B has to take instructions, requests, and so on. And Roman 3 says that because of powers conferred on person A by the constitutional document, it is calculated on the percentage. And we also have an agent. And in the paragraph 5, if there's more than one agent, how it should be calculated. Well, the agent will also have some controlling interests and shareholding. Okay, Chairman. The application is, I'll use an example. Let's say A has a half of B, and B has a three quarters and so on. That's all it means. So I'll move on to 50AAI, the transaction and series of transactions. So these include related transactions, and IRD has explained that, why it has to be drafted, because we can involve transactions where there are no parties A and B, or just one party. So the drafting of that is also made in reference to the UK laws. Mr. Chung? Well, transaction includes planning, practice. Isn't that very wide in scope? If we have operation, scheme, arrangement, and I can understand there's participation, but understanding, it's also part of a transaction. Now, wouldn't that be too abstract? How can an understanding be part of a transaction? Deputy Commissioner, could you provide some examples? I don't think that's a new idea. There have been some court rulings. Could you explain how is it different from OEC definition? Well, as I said, it's not created by Hong Kong. Also made reference to the UK's compliance with OECD. Let's give you an example. Let's say an overseas enterprise has associated with a Hong Kong enterprise, but they don't pay, so they might have an understanding. They have an understanding that fees are not charged. So in transfer pricing, that's not allowed, even though you have an understanding. But you have to consider the interest, the arm's length transaction. And if a third person were to use this IP, your patent, you charge them $100. So even though this foreign enterprise, you should still charge them $100. Mr. Chung? So that means the company has provided another company their patent and charged for that patent. They charge one company but not the other company. But if they don't charge anybody, then this will not occur, right? Deputy Commissioner? Well, Mr. Jones, that's hard to answer because typically we don't know an independent third person where they are not charged. if there really is a independent third party where you don't charge them, I don't see how you have to charge them in this related transaction. But if it's an independent transaction, arm's length transaction, and you charge money, then I don't see why with a related transaction you don't charge them. Well, I can understand. If you have to pay, they have an income, and I don't charge the other company, I understand that. But let's say that patent, it's only conducted with one company and I don't charge them, and it's understood that they don't have to pay. But does that mean you have to create a value and therefore charge tax them on that? Let me see if I understand the question. You're saying that if there's a independent third party and they are not charged, and in general they are not charged, then why you have to charge the related transaction, related enterprise? An independent third party, typically you charge them. But is it possible that you don't charge an independent third party? Let's say, for example, I'm doing two transactions for you. You earn more money, and the second transaction you earn less. So in actual transfer pricing, in the implementation of the rules, we have to examine all the facts. We have to see, aside from a narrow transaction, do we have to examine a wider scope? You can have a wide range and a narrow range. So we have to look at the objective facts. Mr. Chung, I understand that should be the case. You cannot say they are taxed just because of an understanding. If their whole business model, where they don't charge anybody for the patent, there's no value then. But if the patent, it's only used by one related company, or there could also be no fee charged. We'll have to just look at the circumstances. How many transactions are there? Why is one transaction not charged? We have to also examine that. Well, let's say the business is not that great, so they say, we're not going to charge. So during the interim period, we'll help you go through the difficult period. That could be an understanding. We're not going to charge on this occasion. We're going to charge on the next occasion. But you might question, why are they not charged on this occasion? It might be a deliberate form of assistance to help them bring down costs. In actual fact, that would happen. You are talking about independent companies, right? Even for related companies, they could be subsidiaries. I hold the patent. I might have to charge them before, but they might be going through a difficult period, and they're not. You know, I don't charge them, and I will charge you when the business picks up. That could happen. But IRD identifies that, and they question, why aren't they charged? But it could be business is bad, and I just want to help them through a difficult spot. So that might people might fall foul of that. The transfer pricing is only applied to related transactions. If they don't charge, we're not trying to cover when they charge a non-related company. The issue we're facing is that if there's a transaction, and if it's a related transaction, and if it is different from an independent third-party transaction, then we might make an adjustment. So Mr. Chung said the subsidiary business is not doing so good, I want to help them out, then that might not be equivalent to an independent third-party transaction. Well, put bluntly, other third parties might be doing bad and they might have to declare bankruptcy. So I explained our legislation is only applied to related transactions, and it's different from independent third party transaction. It also has to be potential tax liability to make that adjustment. Mr. Zhong? Well, independent third party, of course, I don't care whether they go bankrupt or not. But for related transactions, it might be a subsidiary. Oh, then that's why I would help them. But if I help them and fall foul of the law, let me ask a separate question. It's a related transaction, a related enterprise. So company A issues an invoice to company B. They pursue it for a while, and enterprise B is a related enterprise. They are in a difficult spot. They can't pay. So let's say after a year or so, company A makes provisions. Company B asks company A not to charge them. Company A has a document. The board says, "Okay, we'll set it off as a provision and write it off as bad debt." So in transfer pricing, the bad debt write-off would cover that. So if we have documents indicating that the bad debt procedure and it's no different from a third party transaction, in their pursuit of bad debt, but they don't want the company to go bankrupt, and they cannot recover the costs, so company A will have to write it off. So under these conditions, would you apply transfer pricing, or would you have separate consideration, Deputy Commissioner? Chairman's analysis is very insightful and correct. So after transfer pricing, there might be bad debt, and ultimately the outcome is the same. But with transfer pricing, it ensures that it guarantees our tax assessment, because if they make a bad debt provision, we might still be able to recover that tax assessment. So in the short term, I don't see a big difference. It's just a case of postponement. So, Mr. Chung, you can make reference to my alternate suggestion. So let me move on to 0034, the potential advantage. So I'd like the committee to look at the CSA paper, page 26, 27. So the potential advantage, and on page 1, the bill had indicated that the profit is, or the loss has increased. That's easy to comprehend. So we received a lot of opinion from the industry and deputation submissions where they mention, the secretary also said that we want to exempt local transactions. And the practice now, we add 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And the purpose is to exempt local transactions where they won't be affected by transfer pricing legislation. So which transactions are deemed where they don't have potential advantage? There are three conditions. Paragraph 2A says that it has to be local. B is where they don't have a tax difference, or it's a non-operational loan. In other words, B, there are two scenarios. C is simple. It just says it's not for tax evasion. And the tax evasion is to transfer the loss. And that's easy to comprehend. So, Chairman, I am now looking at paragraph 3, the local scenario. Local scenario, there are two possibilities. When the two persons are conducting business in Hong Kong, they are doing business in Hong Kong, they are paying Hong Kong tax. That would be a local nature. And item B, one is doing business in Hong Kong, the other one is not doing business in Hong Kong. Then the other one has to be a Hong Kong tax resident. And the actual transaction, and then the other Hong Kong resident business are not related. That is the scenario.
And then explain paragraph 4. So what do we mean by trade professional business carried out in Hong Kong? It is not just about a sum received or received by the person is deemed under section 15.1, that is a deeming provision. And to paragraph 5, we explain what we meant by no actual tax difference condition. Each affected person's income arising from the relevant activities is chargeable to Hong Kong tax. And at the same time, no concession or exemption for Hong Kong tax applies to any affected person. So, for example, no tax to be paid or not subject to half tax regime. So, in other words, the income for both parties have to be taxed, and no party is enjoying preferential tax treatment. 6. The non-business loan condition is put in there in response to the deputation's views, especially the proposal by Rida on the intercompany loan. The non-business loan condition is met if the actual provision relates to lending money otherwise than in the ordinary course of a business of lending money or an intra-group financing business, because for these businesses there will be profit and they will be subject to preferential tax regime very often. 7 is about the tax avoidance purpose. Under the IO, there is already this provision, and that is the laws should not be transferred. And paragraph 8, we add in the definition of relevant activities, and that has the meaning given by section 50 AAL. You have sought the advice of the drafting section and did a lot, but have you taken reference from similar provisions in other countries, or you drafted it from scratch? Can I ask the draftsman to give an answer for these provisions? In the course of drafting, the IRD has provided similar provisions in the UK for our reference, but the Deputy Commissioner has said something about the opinions of Rida and also interest-free loans, etc. These matters are not set out in the British laws. So for some of these other elements, they're unique to Hong Kong only. Any question? If not, then we'll move on to the next provision. And then 50AAK, and that is subdivision to rule 2 of transfer pricing, and that applies to non-Hong Kong resident person having a permanent establishment in Hong Kong and how they should attribute income. Well, honestly speaking, for 50AAK, there is a similar provision in IRO already, and that is a 17G in the IRO that is applicable to financial institutions. But for 17G, that is related to regulatory capital security. And some of the definitions were made and catered to the financial institutions. But basically the content is similar and it manifests or meets with the OECD requirements. And from 888 note, we said that that will only commence in on the 1st of April 2019. The legal advisor has a question. Thank you, Chairman. On 58AK, subsection 2, it means that this company is dealt wholly independently. And in 58AC1, there is a definition of independent enterprise. Is that different from this, the clause here? And how are these two different provisions used? We are talking about the same company. Having permanent establishments in different tax jurisdictions. In actual fact, it is the same organization. It is not two different or several different enterprises. For the sake of assessing the tax, the permanent establishments in different places will be viewed as a distinct and separate enterprise. And 50AAF, we talk about two affected persons. Well, so it's somehow different. And the wordings are also correspondingly different. Legal advisor, any further question? Deputy Commissioner, please continue. Let's take a look at 50AAK paragraph 1. Without limiting section 14, a non-Hong Kong resident person who has a permanent establishment in Hong Kong is regarded as carrying on a trade, profession, or business in Hong Kong. And then subparagraph 2, as mentioned briefly just now, because we're talking about the same enterprise, so it's called permanent establishment. Well, in English, we may call it a branch. Deputy Commissioner, AAK bracket 1, without limiting section 14, under transfer pricing rule, it is regarded as carrying on a trade professional business in Hong Kong. In other words, if it is not a permanent establishment, it can still carry on a trade professional business. But then under section 14, even if it has a permanent establishment, you can argue that it is not carrying on a trade professional business in Hong Kong. So does section 14 cover only transfer pricing, or the fundamentals of profit tax have been changed here? Now, this is a rule on transfer pricing. We haven't changed the conditions for levying profit tax under IRO. So this is very much a clarification only. So in generally, if you have a permanent establishment, I must point out that, well, there are different possibilities for permanent establishments. One, that is, well, that is a that comes under a definition of permanent establishment in an agreement signed between Hong Kong and an overseas tax jurisdiction. If that is not the case, we can take reference from Schedule 17G for its definition. Generally, permanent establishments under tax treaties have this threshold, and that is overseas tax residents must have a permanent establishment before Hong Kong can tax this permanent establishment. So the way it is drafted means that we are not changing the IRO, and at the same time, we are meeting with the requirements of the tax agreements. Paragraph 2. We must view the permanent establishment as one, as a distinct and separate enterprise. So a branch and a subsidiaries should come with a similar tax assessment methodology. And so they are also engaged in the same or similar activities under the same or similar conditions and dealt wholly independently with the person, whether they are dealing with the parent company or a third party, the same assessment method should apply. And then in implementing paragraph 2, we must take on board the relevant functions performed, assets used, and the risk assumed by the person, and through the permanent establishment and through the other parts of the person. In applying subsection 2, we must also consider the credit rating of the permanent establishment and make sure that the equity and loan capital that it could reasonably be expected to have is the same as the parent enterprise. Paragraph 5. Transactions between the permanent establishment and any other part of the person are treated as taking place on the terms that would have been agreed between parties dealing at arm's length. Paragraph 6. No deduction is to be allowed for costs and expenses in excess of those that would have been incurred on the assumptions set out in subsection 4. Paragraph 7 has to do with the procedure. That is to safeguard the enterprise's interest. The assessor must give a notice to the person requiring the person to do the following within a reasonable time stated in the notice: to state the amount of income or loss according to the arm's length principle. A notice may be given whether or not any assessment has already been made, and if the person fails to prove to the assessor's satisfaction, then the assessor can make an estimate. As pointed out by the Mr. Felix Chong, the right of appeal also exists. Now, paragraph 10. We have proposed an amendment as stated in the consolidated version, and we have added in an equally reliable measure. The chairman asked whether there is a place which mentions particularly that the arm's length amount means in effect an arm's length range. So that's where it is seen. Any question, members? All right, Deputy Commissioner. You can continue and go to Division 3. Okay, let's go to page 0037, 50 AAL, Interpretation on Relevant Activities. Deputy Commissioner, can you tell us what is the aim of Division 3? What matters will it handle? In Division 2, we discuss the IRD taking the initiative to make adjustment on transfer pricing. And Division 3, so title is clear, and that is about relief. Well, we use the word relief in relation to the relevant concessions. Say, for example, if the advantaged person has been asked to pay more tax, whether in Hong Kong or overseas, then Hong Kong has a duty to reduce the tax on the part of the disadvantaged person. So Division 3 is about relief, and that is not an addition, but rather a deduction. Okay, let's continue. 50 AAL is an interpretation, relevant activities. Well, let me put it in this way. Say for A sells something to B, and then B sells it to a third party, and there is a transaction between A and B. Maybe it is not in order, the arm's length principle is not used, and they are associated to enterprises. So when we talk about the transfer pricing adjustment, we have to take on board the B's relevant activities, because B is selling the goods to an external party or third party.
And this does not include the daily activities of the person, and if it's only related to one part of the business. So this is made reference to the UK laws. It's not just invented by Hong Kong. 50AM is the corresponding relief not involving foreign tax. So Hong Kong IRD regarding Hong Kong tax resident has done a transfer pricing adjustment, and the advantage person has increased, and now IRD has to reduce the taxable amount for the disadvantaged. So we have to make one positive and one negative adjustment. So you need to explain the advantaged person. So is it an advantage after adjustment, or is it before transfer pricing there was an advantage? Could you clarify that? Chairman is correct. So before transfer pricing, they had received an advantage. So after adjustment, the advantaged person doesn't have an advantage. Mr. Chung, I would like an example, a concrete example. So one person is advantaged and the other person is disadvantaged. Well, Deputy Commissioner, you said A sells to B and B sells retail. So could you explain how a disadvantaged person and disadvantaged person appears, and how do we apply 50AAM? So A sells something cheaply to B, and B, B's cost is lower, and A has made less profits and will pay less tax. So A is the advantaged person, and B, because will resell, and B, the cost is lower, they have a higher profit. So Mr. Chung, do you follow? Yes? Chairman, well, from the IRD perspective, A makes less profit, so they pay less tax. B makes more profit, and B pays more tax. So from IRD perspective, there is no impact on their tax revenue. You might be correct, but if both are Hong Kong tax residents, well, I don't want to do his job, so I'll let the commissioner explain. Well, Mr. Chung's question is very topical. We've made an amendment. We have exempted local transactions. Of course, it has to be local nature. There has to be no tax difference, and there's no tax evasion. So even if both enterprises are in Hong Kong, and if you don't satisfy my three conditions, I have to do some addition and then a subtraction. That would be fair. So I think the legislation here is to safeguard enterprises. So as the title mentioned by Chairman, it's a relief. So it's beneficial to enterprises. I have to point that out. Mr. Chung, I don't understand, Chairman. Because my question just now was, one makes less profit, the makes less profit pays less tax, one makes more profit and pays more tax. So how is that related to relief? The IRD still collects so much tax if everybody is filing correctly. So Deputy Commissioner, could you explain in greater detail how the relief is treated fairly after the transfer pricing adjustment is made. So A sells to B and B sells retail. So B collects the full rate and as the half rate regime. So therefore, there's a incentive to give all the profits to B so they can pay 8.2% and A pays less tax because A is the advantaged person. So assuming IRD examines that and according to the law, according to the arm's length transaction, they have to pay more tax. At the same time, A pays more tax, then we have to be fair to B, so B has to pay less tax. So after the adjustment, so even though they are paying the half rate tax, but they will be given the adjustment to B to pay. So there's more tax collected from A and B will have less tax collected. In actual practice, so when the IRD investigates A, how do you prove A deliberately sold cheap to B so that B has higher profit? So that might not be easy to accomplish. Of course you can have the legislation, that's reasonable. Deputy Commissioner, so Mr. Chung's question, we will encounter that in each case. If there's a transfer pricing, the first step is we have to conduct a functional analysis. The legislation examines the action, the asset, the risk, and then we have to do the comparability. So taking these actions and having these assets and bearing this risk, how will it affect profitability? And I make so much profit between this related transaction. And in a third-party transaction, how much profit will I make? So you have to go through the two steps, the functional analysis and the comparability analysis, to come to a preliminary conclusion. Mr. Chung? Please continue. So I'll continue at 58 a.m. Just now I mentioned when we do the subtraction, there are three possibilities. There could be a local transaction, one add, one minus. And in the other scenario is in 58 a.m., a Hong Kong enterprise, a foreign enterprise, the foreign enterprise add and Hong Kong has the minus. The third scenario is a Hong Kong standing institution and overseas institute has already made an addition. So this is similar. So I'll go through 58 a.m. very quickly. We're saying in paragraph 1 that the circumstances set out in 58 a.m. it is a Hong Kong enterprise. 1A and 1B, you can see they are related to Hong Kong enterprises and they have to pay Hong Kong tax. Paragraph 2, the disadvantaged person, if they make an application, then it is to be computed for the purposes of Hong Kong tax as if the arm's length provision had been made instead of the actual provision. So that means we have to make it an arm's length transaction. So if the disadvantaged person forgets to do so, you won't do so automatically because, you know, even if you have that information, you won't remind them. Is that correct? And how long do they have to make the notification within the limitation period? In 58 a.m., there are two enterprises. Mr. Chung asked a very detailed question. After the adjustment, what is the factual basis? And what is the intention? Is the pure intention? Do we have objective standards? So, in transfer pricing, when both enterprises are Hong Kong enterprises, when you do A, I have to clarify which enterprise is B. So B should be aware of that situation. And these are the controlled and related enterprises. But if the enterprise forgets, the IRD has an obligation to notify them that they should do so timely. But I think in all circumstances, the tax consultant won't forget these, and there should be a sufficient limitation period. Paragraph 3, in applying subsection 2, we need to comply with the previous adjustment mentioned in paragraph 3. Paragraph 4 is, if the disadvantaged person makes a claim, but if the loss has already been computed, the income or loss has been computed, so the assessor needs to do it all over again. And paragraph 5 is about the limitation period. It is 6 years after the end of the relevant year of assessment, or the end of 6 months after the date on which an assessment is made imposing liability, or the end of 6 months after the date on which a computation of loss, and whichever is the latest. And that should cover the majority of cases. I want to ask, 5A is 6 years. If they discovered an adjustment and notified you within 6 years, but they are arguing over the amount. So the 6 years, does it become irrelevant because you're still arguing the amount? So let's say the adjustment for the advantaged person, and they are still arguing that. And the transfer pricing cases can take a long time. The disadvantaged party is aware of the adjustment within the six-year period. They make a claim, but the amount has not been settled. So, Chairman, your example is a technical question. So, it seems that it's a very short period of notification, but in practice, in transfer pricing cases, when two Hong Kong enterprises are involved, in practice, as long as one party makes an application, they are speaking on behalf of the group. So we deal with it flexibly. The disadvantaged party, we deem it as application being made, and the disadvantaged will have an opportunity to receive a deduction. So that's not a big technical problem, but no matter what, if you look at 5B, they still have another 6 months. B and C refer to 6 months. So I'll look at paragraph 6. For the purposes of subsection 2 or 4, an assessor may give a notice to the disadvantaged person requiring the disadvantaged person to prove within a reasonable time stated in the notice. And paragraph 8 also repeats my procedure just now. If the assessor does not agree to the application, of course they have a basis for assessment. And paragraph 9 says, if an assessor refuses to revise the disadvantaged person's assessment, the assessor must give a written notice, and the advantaged person has the same rights of objection and appeal, and they have to give an equally reliable measure or more reliable measure, and that's on page 28 of where we refer to 50 AAM. Paragraph 10. A more reliable. Any questions? Please continue. So assuming the assessor accepts the application and amends the assessment, the taxpayer has to take reasonable steps to ensure that they, within 3 months, will have to make notification of any further assessment.
Paragraph 12. If there is further adjustment, then a corresponding adjustment can also be made. And an assessment or additional assessment can also be made. Paragraph 13 sets out the time limitation for further adjustment. That should be done by the end of 2 years from the time when the adjustment on an advantaged person is made, or an expiry of the time limit for making an assessment or additional assessment under this ordinance, whichever is later. Paragraph 13A, you can't have 6 plus 2. It should be within that 6 years, right? 6 years refer to the first assessment and the downward adjustment. And for 13, so if the commissioner proposes a deduction, then maybe the advantaged person can get a further reduction, then and another addition has to be made. So one is addition, the other is subtraction, but then the party with the addition may then have to receive a deduction, and the other party has to receive an addition then. While he can have an addition after an addition, why does the deduction follow the addition? Well, the drafting, well, is similar to existing provisions in the IRO. Maybe there is a possibility that after the addition, the relevant person fails to provide certain information or evidence, then, he is allowed to have deduction. And then if a deduction is made, the addition has to be made on the other party. So overall, it's to safeguard the taxpayer's interest. Mr. Chung, I really don't understand what the Deputy Commissioner said. Now, for this side, there is an addition, and then there is a downward adjustment later on. And the Deputy Commissioner said that. That is because certain information has not been furnished to prove that he warrants the addition. What kind of information are you referring to, Deputy Commissioner? Well, let's again use the A and B example. There is a transaction between A and B. We think that it's not done at an arm's length principle. And then A has to have an addition. And then under 50AM, we have to deduct the amount for the other party. Now, A can give further evidence to the IRD saying that there is a mistake made in proposing this addition. If he meets with the time limit, well, then there may be a further adjustment, a downward adjustment, and that is to safeguard A's interest. He has a right to do so. And at the same time, for B, there has been a deduction, then we have to have an addition because the other side is having a deduction. Now, as to the kind of information I refer to, it's very difficult to say what it is exactly. Maybe it's documents, past records of transactions, etc. If A can further provide such information, it can ask for a reassessment be made. Mr. Chung, any further questions? No. Deputy Commissioner, please continue. And then 50 AAN. Well, the concept here is similar to the previous provision. Now, we're talking about the case involving a tax overseas tax jurisdiction. The Hong Kong enterprise is a disadvantaged party. The overseas party is an advantaged party. Subsection A just repeats the AAF definition. Paragraph 2 sets out the basis for adjustment. There is a double taxation arrangement in place between Hong Kong and this overseas tax jurisdiction. The solution lies with a MAP solution, MAP arm's length provision. Then we agree that the solution be arrived at based on the bilateral agreement. Is there a definition for MAP in the earlier part? I can't recall. Yes, there is. Let me check. Can you remind me where the MAP definition lies? In 0016 of the marked up copy. AAB on page 16, we discuss the DTA arrangement and also requirements in relation to arbitration, and that is written into the statutory law in Hong Kong, and that meets with the OECD requirements. And OECD sets out the MAP solution on page 17. We talk about MAP solution in paragraph 6. And through the MAP solution and procedures, we will settle the case. So it's just that for the MAP solution, this time the arm's length principle applies. Let's go back to page 43. In paragraph 3, it is stated if a disadvantaged person's tax has been adjusted, and he must take reasonable steps to ensure that any further adjustment is made, then he should notify the commissioner within 3 months. And even the commissioner knows about this, further adjustment has to be made. And in paragraph 4, it is said that in the related adjustment, the assessed income or loss has to be computed again. And paragraph 5 sets out the period to be 2 years from the time when the advantaged person's foreign tax-related adjustment is made or the expiry of the time limit for making an assessment under this ordinance, whichever is the later. Mr. Chung, a simple question. Compared to other tax jurisdictions, Hong Kong has a lower tax regime. Especially now we have a two-tier profits tax system. So, it is more possible for Hong Kong enterprises to be made to pay more tax. And because overseas jurisdictions will say that you shift the profits to Hong Kong, where you can pay a lower tax. So does it mean that it is more probable for Hong Kong enterprises to be paying more tax ultimately? Or no. Well, there is transfer pricing regime to be put in place just because enterprises may be paying more tax in Hong Kong. But after the adjustment is made, the Hong Kong enterprises will be paying less tax. Is that right? Deputy Commissioner, both your understanding is correct, the Chairman and Mr. Chung. Let's take a look at the procedures. Mr. Chung talks about the first step. Hong Kong has a low tax regime. Overseas tax jurisdictions have higher tax rates. So if an enterprise doesn't adopt the arm's length principle. It is incentivized to put all the profits in Hong Kong. Then they will not have any profits tax. I mean profits in an overseas country. So Hong Kong government has the duty to deduct the tax. We are talking about associated enterprises. For the overseas enterprise, they have to pay the tax subject to the prevailing tax rates there. And in Hong Kong, the enterprise has to pay less tax because of this. And that is according to the tax arrangement. Okay, 50 AAO. It talks about the same overseas enterprise, but then it has a permanent establishment in Hong Kong. Now for 50 AAO, well, it is similar to 50 AAN. And that the MAP solution has to be used. But now, this is not using the MAP arm's length provision, rather MAP attribution, and that is set out in 50 AAO2B. Why do you have to use the term attribution and not the arm's length or arbitration? Because Article 7 sets out this term attribution in the tax agreement, because we are referring to the same enterprise. And then page 46, paragraph 3, it talks about the situation where the assessment has been adjusted. The tax resident has to initiate certain procedures, notify the within three months the commissioner, and then the commissioner will make further adjustments. And then it talks about the time period. So that's about Division 3. A moment, please. Any questions from the members? On Division 3, in 50 AAO Chinese version, there is a typo. 50 AAO Chinese version, page 46. Page 46 of the Chinese version. A moment, please. Oh, please, continue. The English version is right. But then in page 0046, 3B2, Roman letter 2, the third line, 或虧損定, well, it should be 或虧損, so we delete the word ding in the Chinese version, so it's just a typo mistake to be amended. So any other matters under Division 3 here? Well, because for Division 4, advanced pricing arrangement is a very important division here. I don't believe we will finish Division 4 today, so maybe we will start discussing Division 4 in the next meeting on advanced pricing arrangement. Some members have asked me to adjourn the meeting 10 minutes earlier. So date for next meeting, it is the 23rd of May. Time is 8:30 to 10:30 a.m. It's a Wednesday, so I'm sorry, you have to come back earlier. It's from 8:30 to 10:30. And then the ninth meeting is scheduled for the 4th of June from 2:30 to 4:30 p.m. Do you think it's the timetable is all right? If needed, we will be having the 10th meeting sometime in June, and I'll see whether we can finish the scrutiny of this bill by the end of this legislative session. Mr. Wong Ting Kwong. The legislative session will close on the 13th of July. So even if we try to rush things through, we can't have the second reading resumed within the legislative session. I'm not thinking about that. I just want to finish the clause-by-clause scrutiny within the session. Now, when we are done with the Bills Committee's work, now after the summer break, I think we will not recall the content of the bill. You want to finish the Bills Committee stage before the summer recess? Yes, my suggestion is to finish the Bills Committee's work before the end of this session. So, well, after the session, we have to, try to remember things.
I'd like to follow up on Mr. Wong Ding-gong's question. So, if we would like to complete or resume second reading before summer recess, and if the bill committee before we can complete the scrutiny before mid-June, it's possible. So even though you're saying that we're only at page 40-odd in 160-odd pages, I think we are already dealing with the complex part. In the second half, they are just about the document, the master file, and so on, and that's in compliance with the OECD. So the controversial parts are not that probable. So if the chairman wishes more from continuity, we should aim for the June scrutiny completion. So seeking for a second reading or third reading would be even more aggressive. Mr. Wong Ding-gong. Yes, we would like to have efficiency. I would support that if we could achieve it, but I'm concerned with the Secretariat's workload. So we have to report to the House Committee. We have to provide an oral report, and there's also other secretarial work. Can we meet all these deadlines? So unless the beginning of June, if we complete the bill committee scrutiny work, and by mid-June, we'll have to report to the House Committee by end of June. So we have to make it by the last day on 13th of July. I don't want to add to the workload of the Secretariat, and I don't want to just have an oral report. This is a very important bill, and we need a written report. So I do have the feeling that we have very standard clauses. It's the same as OECD towards the end. And of course, we have to consider the Secretariat's workload. And we also understand there is the co-location bill. So I think on 6th of June, the co-location bill will return to the House Committee. So Wednesdays and Thursdays in June will be given to the co-location bill. Yes, we would like to step up our pace. I feel that you are overworking the secretary. Let's see what happens. Okay, I see the progress is, we have a decent progress. We don't have to rush. We would like a detailed report. So, let's proceed. Any further opinion? Okay, thank you. We'll see you next time.